Olá, hoje eu vou conversar com o Greg Wolf, né, da Universidade de Los Angeles, da Califórnia, e eu vou pedir para ele se apresentar, ok? Ele é doutor em história. Greg, fale um pouco da sua trajetória e do teu trabalho.
Olá, Deodato. I was born in the south of England, and I was educated in the universities of Oxford and Cambridge, and taught at Leicester and Oxford. And then I worked in Scotland for 20 years, and then directed the Institute of Classical Studies in London. And now, since September, I have been professor of ancient history in the University of California at Los Angeles. So I've changed country three times. It's very nice to be speaking with you today.
Ok, thank you. Eu vou conversar hoje como eu já falei, com o Greg. Nós vamos conversar sobre um livro que ele coordenou, que ele editou em parceria com outro editor, a respeito. Deixa eu colocar aqui, ó.
Yeah, so.
Das religiões no Império Romano. Vou colocar em português também para quem estiver no Brasil aqui. Deixa eu ver aqui.
Yep,
Tá aí, ó,
Sensorium.
os sentidos do no politeísmo romano. É um trabalho extremamente interessante. Vou fazer algumas perguntas que eu já combinei, inclusive, com o Greg. E na medida que ele for respondendo, eu vou colocar em língua portuguesa aqui abaixo, no que eu chamo de banner. Greg, quais foram os editores que trabalharam junto com você nesse livro?
This book, Sensorium, was a joint project between myself and Professor Jaime Alvar at the Universidad Carlos III in Madrid, and Anton Alvar Nuno, who is a teacher of ancient history in the University of Malaga in Spain. And it was created as part of an exchange program funded by the Banco de Santander. In the course of which I spent some time in Madrid and Jaime spent some time in London. So this is a fruit of an international collaboration, and it was great fun to do.
Ok. Deixa eu me colocar aqui do seu lado. Eu queria que você me falasse, Greg, vou me colocar aqui do teu lado. Este livro, qual foi o interesse em se trabalhar esse livro?
Oh, I'm glad the book seems interesting to you. We thought it was interesting as well. It's an attempt to explore Roman religion in a new way and to think of it not so much as a set of institutions, nor a set of customs or texts, but to think about the experience of the worshippers and the people who take part. And so this is part of a larger campaign of investigating Roman religion as a lived experience, as something which we can compare to the everyday rituals that we know in our own societies.
Ok. Eu queria que você nos falasse qual foi, assim, o real interesse em se trabalhar. Foram, assim, trabalhados os significados, conhecimentos, experiências e também a ação no mundo a partir, da observação das religiões no Império Romano?
Yes, precisely. So, what anthropologists and historians of religion do today, when they can participate and watch a ritual, we have to reconstruct for the Roman world on the basis of their texts and their objects and their artworks. But we're essentially doing the same thing, just as you say.
Ok. Me fala uma coisa, nos dois primeiros capítulos foram abordados os lances, as questões da morte em Lucrécio, né? Você pode falar um pouquinho sobre essa questão?
Well, Lucretius is a philosopher who wrote in verse, and he wrote a poem called On the Nature of Things, which is a a cosmogony and a history of the world, but senses for him are different than for us, because the Epicureans believed that seeing something was the same as touching it, and that when you have a picture, it's because objects come off the thing you're looking at and touch your eyes. And so for the Epicureans, their theory of optics, their optical theory, is really a theory of touch. It's a haptic theory. And so these two chapters that we begin with explore this, to us, a very alien notion of touch, of sight, which is almost something physical. And so questions like seeing a ghost means actually a ghost has to be a physical object that then sends off emanations, which you then encounter the skin of your eyes. And the same with the gods. And so it's useful to us to think about the Roman senses, because it draws attention to some huge differences between the way they imagine the senses and the way we do. So it's a completely materialist version of optics. So those two first chapters, which are quite philosophical in content, they explore that physicality of sight.
Ok. Particularmente me chamou muita atenção o terceiro e o quarto capítulo, justamente pelo tema abordado, pelo que foi pesquisado no Império Romano. Eu vou colocar a pergunta aqui, porque ela está ligada aos rituais extremos, e ao sofrimento humano. Vou colocar aqui, ó, tá aqui, ó.
You're quite right, yes. What we then move on from something that is not at all philosophical, but something that is much more ecstatic or bizarre. The people who have these extreme reactions by walking across hot coals or subjecting their bodies to what seem to us to be very extreme experiences. And the scholars who investigate this have done a lot of comparison with modern firewalkers. So in this case, we reconstruct Roman senses of religion by looking at ecstatic experiences today, at sort of rituals of extreme trances that people go into. So this gives us the opposite end of Roman century religion, not philosophical, but more but physical and extreme, and something which for the participants must have been a completely absorbing experience. So again, something very different to our experience, but also very different to the way that philosophers like Lucrezio imagined it.
Ok. Deixa eu me colocar aqui do seu lado. Pronto. Greg, tem um outro capítulo lá onde os pesquisadores abordam o triunfo dos sentidos e colocam lá dois pontos, né? A consciência sensorial e o divino nas celebrações públicas romanas. Você pode falar um pouco sobre essas celebrações públicas? Vou colocar aqui para você.
Certo, yes, of course. The triumph is the great procession that Romans do after they win a victory in war. And there are many accounts and many images and temples built. And this is a celebration. So after the victory, the general will be dressed as a god, and there'll be a long, slow procession round the streets of the city of Rome, and behind him will come the army, and then their prisoners, and then piles of booty they've gathered, so gold, coin, treasures, and perhaps there'll be images of mountains they've captured or cities that they sacked, and then there might even be placards, so big sort of banners giving the names of the people they've conquered. And we know quite a lot about this from text, and also this shows how the sensory side of this would have been one of bright colors, so sparkling gold. The general would wear the same brightly colored robes that normally hang on the statue of gods. Then there'd be trumpets, sounds. And the sounds would attract people's attention. And then the images would fix their eyes on particular bits of the procession. So we're seeing an engagement with many senses, so noise, sight, perhaps also even a sense of vibration, the stamping of the feet of the soldiers as they march through the city. And so the triumph creates a sensory experience that's shared not just by the general and the soldiers and the prisoners, but also by the crowds all around. The whole city for a while comes together. And really, if you need to compare this, you think about sitting in a football stadium and the moment where your team scores a goal against the other side. And at that moment, suddenly everybody shouts out and they stand up and they yell and the crowd seems to move like it's one body. And that's what the Roman triumph was like. It was like that extraordinary coordination of people who just for one moment are all looking the same direction, all shouting the same thing, all moving together like a great dance. And so that is how the researchers approach the Roman triumph in our book as a huge sensory experience that brings the people together, just like that moment in a football stadium where your team scores the goal.
Ok. Vamos falar um pouquinho agora. Deixa eu me colocar aqui do seu lado. Deixa eu me colocar aqui. Vamos falar um pouquinho agora sobre as procissões no Império Romano. As procissões no Império Romano. Queria saber como se dava, Greg, a inserção da música e da religiosidade, das religiões na narrativa ligadas às procissões. Eu vou colocar a pergunta aqui para você falar também aí. Tá aqui, ó. Pronto.
Well, music takes part in many Roman rituals and in the very traditional ancient ones, during the sacrifice, it's important that no bad sound disturbed the ritual. And so they would play, if you look at a picture of a sacrifice, you'll see people playing a flute to drown out inauspicious noises. So during the final ritual, there's this flute music. So that's something Romans would be very familiar with. But Rome is a world empire. And there are gods there and rituals from all over it. So each one has their own particular style of music. So the goddess Isis from Egypt, her rituals, they're accompanied by a rattling noise that goes on. So special rattles. We see the images of the rattle, the sistrum, on statues of the goddess Isis and of her priests. Or the priests of the great mother of the gods Kybele from Anatolia. They would have drums, tambourines. And so sometimes you'd hear an exotic sound and this would tell you, well, this god is a bit unusual. This is a foreign god in our city at making foreign music on strange instruments. And then sometimes you'd hear traditional music, the trumpets of the Roman army or the flutes of a Roman sacrifice. So there's a whole range of different musics being brought together, and which music you hear is telling you a bit about what kind of religion you're participating in. And that would be something which eventually Romans would come to understand, all these different religious registers. Just like when we listen to music, we can tell whether it's something sort of from the Indian subcontinent, whether it's classical European music, whether it's jazz music, and each one of them brings different sensations and associations. And the Romans too had this very rich repertoire of musical experiences.
Okay. Greg, para encerrar, eu gostaria que você falasse um pouco mais sobre a busca desses novos sentidos no politeísmo do Império Romano. Vou colocar a pergunta aqui para você falar aí. Repetir também?
Yes, I think one of the big advantages of looking at the senses in this way is that we do explore new dimensions of Roman polytheism, that we knew a lot about it already. We knew what it looked like. We know the costumes, the statues. We know about the rules because they're often inscribed in Greek and Latin inscriptions. And we knew about the reactions of other people, particularly the reactions that Christians had to polytheism. But hearing a religion described or reading its laws isn't quite the same as knowing what it would be like to take part in it. And so it's the participation in religion that senses really get to, and it makes it seem more vivid, more exciting, more entrancing. And we have perhaps a bit of a sense of what it would have been like to be there, to think about. And we've talked about sight, we've talked about music, talked about sound. There's also the smell of it. One of the big features of a Roman ritual would have been the burning of incense. And Romans imported from India and from the Indian Ocean spices and from Arabia as well, which they used mostly in religion. And so particular smells would make people seem the gods are close. And perhaps for them, as for us, in many of the rituals we're familiar with, smell, a particular smell, a particular taste, a particular sound, a particular music would bring them to a new state of mind, a new state of being. And so if we're looking for the Romans at their most religious, at their most involved in religion, I think thinking about Romans as live bodies that have senses like we do, and who experience religion not just as something cerebral, not as a set of intellectual ideas, but as something physical, something embodied, that is one of the big things that we gain from a proper history of the senses and from a sensory approach to Roman polytheism.
Okay. Para você que está nos assistindo no Brasil e quem está assistindo fora do Brasil também, a gente vai legendar este livro e outros artigos do Greg estão postados na plataforma. Como é o nome da plataforma? É academia.edu. Academia.edu. É só você acessar e procurar pelo nome do Greg você vai encontrar na íntegra, não só o artigo que ele me falou, que acabou sendo um pequeno livro, sobre essa releitura da religiosidade e do sentido da religiosidade no Império Romano. Então, fica aqui a sugestão, vale a pena você entrar na plataforma e assistir. Eu vou colocar o link na descrição. Greg, thank you, muito obrigado.
Thank you. Thank you for your kind words and thank you for inviting me. Muito obrigado.
Ok, muito obrigado a você. Fica aí mais um pouquinho.